Good day, I'm Norman Weilberger. In this video, we're going to carry on with our investigation of basic data structures in mathematics. We're going to be looking at LOMs, which are lists, ordered sets, multisets, and sets. We're just starting to have a little bit of a preliminary discussion about these various important different ways of organizing mathematical objects. Today, we're going to be talking about multisets, the third one on our little list. And in particular, we're going to be looking at very precisely focused multisets, so what we call Mset N, K. These are K multisets from N. It is basically the elements are chosen from the numbers 1, 2, up to N, and we're allowing K objects altogether. So for example, we're going to be especially interested in Mset 5k, so in other words, when n is equal to 5. And we'll be looking at this for various values of k, starting with 0, and then 1, 2, and 3, and so on. So multisets are often not exactly on math students' radar, but they are in fact quite useful. It's very instructive to learn a little bit about them. Their study also raises some interesting questions with regard to identity in maths, which we sort of finesse when we talk about sets all the time. When we talk about multisets, we have to be a little bit more careful about thinking about what does it mean for two objects to be the same. So we'll just flag that as a possible topic for further discussion. All right, so let's have some fun with multisets. So a multiset is a very simple-minded way of organizing mathematical objects. It's sort of the mathematical equivalent of a box, or perhaps a room. So here is a box, and we can use that box to organize things by just putting things inside the box. And then we have a container where those things are stored. For example, we might put some money inside our box. Maybe two 10-cent pieces, a 20-cent piece, and three $2 coins. So then we have a little box full of money. And we can shake that box around. The order of the elements changes, but the essential content of the box is unchanged. And we can organize that in our notation with these square brackets, telling us that repetitions are allowed. And here we just list the elements in some order or another, doesn't matter if we rearrange things. So for example, this multiset and this multiset are the same because they have the same elements the same number of times, even though they're rearranged. Okay, so while set theory has, of course, seen enormous interest and is considered a sort of foundational topic in mathematics, multiset theory is relatively unexamined. It really deserves a little bit more press. It's actually also quite fundamental, and arguably is more fundamental than set theory. We'll see a little bit of that today. So to get an initial handle on things, let's list some K sets from 5. So we'll look at Mset 5K. We'll start with K equals 0, where we just have the empty multiset. When K equals 1, well, there are these 5 possibilities. The multiset 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. When k equals 2, a little bit more interesting, now we're able to list these two multisets. Natural to start with 1, 1. So repetitions are allowed, so we are allowed to put two 1s there. And then 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5. And then 2, 2, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 3, 3, 3, 4, 3, 5, 4, 4, 4, 5, and 5, 5. And in this case, it's relatively easy to organize them, and we can count easily how many there are. And of course, this multiset 3, 4 is the same as the multiset 4, 3, so we don't have to count that separately. Order does not matter. And then we could carry on. So for k equals 3, we could list in some fashion or another the three multisets from 5, and it's natural to start with 1, 1, 1, and ultimately end up with 5, 5, 5. And in this situation, we can keep going by increasing k, so we can look at bigger and bigger k multisets from 5. So there's an unending sequence of possibly bigger and bigger kinds of k sets that we can look at just from 5. A natural notion associated to multisets is the notion of size. So if m is a k multiset from n, then we say that its size is k, because it has exactly k objects inside it. and we use this absolute value kind of notation to denote size. So for example, if m equals 3, 1, 3, 3, 2, 4, 1, that's a mset 5, 7, that was a 7 multiset from 5, then the size of m is 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. The multiplicity of an element. So in this kind of situation, a given element can occur more than once. So it makes sense to give some notation to denote the number of times an element occurs. And we'll use this convention that M, standing for multiplicity, so the multiplicity of A in capital M, M is a multiset, is the number of times that the object A occurs as an element of capital M. So in this example here, the multiplicity in capital M of the element 3 is 3, because it occurs 3 times. While the multiplicity of 1 is just 2, there are 2 occurrences, while the multiplicity of 4 would be 1. So the multiplicity of an element in a multiset. Now let's have a look at operations with multisets. For those of you who have studied set theory, you'll know that unions and intersections are sort of fundamental operations with sets. You might be surprised here that in this multiset situation, the union and intersection are not really the primary operation. The primary operation is a simpler operation of addition. This is not available in set theory, however, it is a fundamental kind of operation in multiset theory. So it's a big difference between set theory and multiset theory. In multiset theory, we have addition of sets. And physically, it corresponds to just about the simplest thing that you could imagine. You have one box full of coins, you have another box full of coins. You just put them both in another box. You just empty out all the elements of both into a third box, and that's called the sum of the two boxes. So for example, the multiset 3, 1, 3, 3, 2, 4, plus the multiset 4, 1, 4, 2. To get the sum, you just combine all of the elements. So we can do that just by listing the elements of the first one up to there, and then just tacking on the elements of the second. Repetitions don't bother us, because repetitions are allowed in our multiset. So we just add all the elements of the two multisets together. And pretty clearly, if A is a KM set from, say, N, and B is, say, an LM set from N, then when we combine them, we're going to get a K plus L M set from N. So A plus B is a K plus L M set from N. The addition of two multisets. Of course, we also have union and intersection as well. They are also, of course, important. So the union of two multisets, how does that go? So here's 3, 1, 3, 3, 2, 4. Here's 4, 1, 4, 2. What happens when we take the union? Well, over here we have 3 threes. So we're going to get 3 threes over here. There are no threes in here, so we're just going to end up with 3 threes in the union. We have 1, 1 here and 1, 1 here. So the max of that is 1. We're going to have 1, 1. We have 1, 2 here and 1, 2 here. The max of that is a single 1, so there's going to be 1, 2. And here there are 1, 4, and here there are 2 4s. And so in the union, we're going to get 2 4s. What's the general rule? The general rule is given this way, that the multiplicity in the union A, union B, of an element X is the maximum of the multiplicities of X in A and in B. So we count how many times does a particular element X appear in A, how many times does it appear in B. We look at those two numbers and we take the maximum. These are natural numbers, or possibly zero, and so one of them will be bigger than the other, or possibly they'll be equal. In any case, we take the biggest of the two numbers. If they're equal, well, we pick that number. And that's how many times X will appear in the union. For the intersection, we do sort of the opposite. We work with the minimum of these two numbers. So if we take the minimum of these two sets, then 3 occurs 3 times here and 0 times here. So the intersection doesn't have any 3s. 1 occurs once here and once here. The minimum of that is 1, so 1 occurs once. 2 occurs once here and once here, so it'll occur once in the intersection. And 4 occurs once here and twice here. The minimum of that is 1. So 4 occurs exactly once. So this is maybe a little bit different way of thinking about what the union and the intersection is. I'll leave it to you to check that if you're restricting yourself to just ordinary sets, then this does correspond to the usual definition of a union or intersection of ordinary sets. So this is an extension of this idea to multisets, crucially using these operations of max and min for natural numbers, plus 0. And a little exercise for you, show that if you take the union of A and B, and you take the intersection of A and B, and you add them, that's something we can do with multisets, then you get the same thing as when you just add A and B directly. So if we added these two, that would be the same thing as adding the two sets originally. So we're going to be talking about the properties of these operations in a further video, but we have to make a little bit of a detour before we do that. I want to introduce the last notion of the idea of a sub-multiset and correspondingly a super-multiset. So the idea of when one multiset is sort of inside another. We're going to adopt somewhat non-standard notation for this inclusion, so pay particular attention to the notation. So here are two multisets, 414 and 4142. So if you like, you can think of these as multisets from 5. Notice that I've written that this multiset is less than or equal to this multiset. What does that mean? Well, it means that this thing is contained within this one. What does that mean? It means that for any element x of A, the multiplicity of x in A is less than or equal to the multiplicity of x in B. That's what we mean when we say A is less than or equal to B. So if we look at 4 here, the 4 has multiplicity 2 over here, and it has multiplicity of 2 over here. 2 is less than or equal to 2. The 1 has multiplicity 1 here and 1 here. 1 is less than or equal to 1. The element 2, which is not actually in here, is less than, well, its multiplicity would be 0, which is less than or equal to 2. But we don't actually need to worry about that because we only need to worry that all the elements of A appear in B at least as many times as they do in A. All right, so in such a case, we'll say that A is a sub-multiset of B. So we read A as a sub-multiset of B. Or if we want to emphasize the relation of B with respect to A, we'll say that B is a super-multiset of A. So those two are equivalent statements. A is a sub-multiset of B. B is a super-multiset of A. And we're introducing this rather novel less than or equal sign for the containment. So we're not using a U, we're using less than or equal to. You'll see that there's a good reason for that in our next video. So let's have a look at all the multisets which are contained inside a given one as sub-multisets. They naturally have an ordered structure because some of the multisets inside are contained in other multisets inside. So if we start with this one, 4142, then here is a picture of the various multisets inside here. And we get a structure which itself has some interesting natural ordered structure by thinking about the relationships between these various sub-multisets. So here is the original one here, and it has 4 multisets within it that have 3 elements. 414, 412, 442, and 142. Now you might say, well, wait a minute, this multiset and this multiset are the same. And that's true. but they are occurring in here in sort of two different ways. So they deserve to be counted twice. It makes sense for us to identify this thing here as being these particular three elements, and this one as being these particular three elements as two different objects within this context. So we have to be a little bit careful about our counting here, but it's a kind of a natural counting. And then the sub-multisets, size 2, 4, 1, talking about these two, which occurs inside here and here. Okay, so notice that this 4, 1 is referring to these two elements here. And so this object here has an inclusion or a line joining it to this one here, but not to this one here, even though as multisets, sort of independent of where they come from, this would be a sub-multiset of this one. So these red bonds here are not exactly the same as our less than or equal to signs. There's something a little bit more subtle going on here that we may have to think about. All right, so you can have a look at the various bonds, and then sort of symmetrically, there's the sub-multisets with just one element, 4, 1, 4, 2, various inclusions, and then symmetrically to the original, the empty multiset, which seems to fit to make a nice symmetrical pattern, so the whole thing has some kind of symmetry with respect to this middle line. So we might think about this as some kind of partially ordered multiset, although the actual elements here are no longer numbers, they are themselves multisets. So we've kind of gone up one level in abstraction. We're no longer just considering multisets whose elements are numbers, but a new kind of object which is consisting of things which themselves are multisets. So we're not really in a position yet to talk about what this is, but sort of we want to head in this direction that we will be able to consider structures which have elements which are themselves structures. So we have data structures within data structures within data structures, etc. So this is sort of natural thing to want to do, reminiscent of the way we organize things in a room. We have a room and bookshelves inside the room, and inside the bookshelves there may be boxes, inside the boxes there may be files, and so on. All right, so we have quite a rich possibility of combining these things eventually. But right now we're just looking at these four basic kinds of objects, which are sort of our starting points, the basic kinds of data objects that we like to look at. And these were the multisets. Okay, so there's more to talk about here, because the algebraic structure that we have here, these various operations, is actually quite interesting. And to understand that a little bit better, it's good to take one step back and to actually think about the natural numbers again. So we are motivated to go back to our natural numbers and have another look at them with a view of understanding the algebra of multisets a little bit more deeply. That's what we'll do next time. We'll talk about the realm of natural numbers. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Weilberger. Thanks for listening.